confirmation bias is like the weather. Everybody talks about it, but nobody does anything about it. I'm going to explain why they don't do anything about it and how they could, and how you could. Now, I assume you've heard of confirmation bias. It's the most famous of all the cognitive biases. It's this tendency, deeply embedded in the human brain apparently, to notice and accept evidence that supports your views and to not notice or to reject evidence that contradicts your views. Evolutionary psychologists have some good answers to the question of why natural selection built this distortion into us. But for purposes of learning how to fight the distortion, that isn't the key question. The key question is, what mechanism did natural selection use to implement the distortion? How does confirmation bias work? And here's a kind of surprising part of the answer. Though confirmation bias is considered a, quote, cognitive bias, which suggests that it's all about our thinking, it turns out that our feelings play a big role in it. If you don't believe me, go do an experiment on social media. Scroll through your feed until you find some news that seems to confirm your views. Like, for example, a leading politician in the enemy tribe, a politician you've always had a very low opinion of and very deep suspicions about, is accused of grave wrongdoing. That news feels good, right? It's information you have a kind of affection for, information you want to embrace. And you want to share it, because you want your friends and political allies to share in the good feeling. You want to spread the joy. So you may click share or retweet or whatever without really giving the story a careful read to see how credible the accusations are. There's a phrase journalists use for an anecdote that may be dubious but is a real attention getter. They say the anecdote is too good to check. Well, the way confirmation bias works is that some bits of news feel too good to check. They also feel so good that they are very memorable and therefore easily accessible for frequent repetition. Now, suppose that the news you come across on your social media feed is that your favorite politician has been accused of wrongdoing. That makes you feel uneasy, right? And maybe skeptical? Like you should read the story to see if the accusations look shaky? And if you find evidence of shakiness, even shaky evidence of shakiness, that will probably feel good and lodge itself firmly in your memory. Now, if I say I have some advice on how to fight confirmation bias, you may say, whoa, wait a second, I have a question. Why should I fight confirmation bias? Sharing good news is fun. And accepting bad news as true is painful. So confirmation bias is working just fine, thanks. I find it very therapeutic. Well, look, it's your call. If you want to walk around with a warped view of the world, perennially deluded about your rightness and goodness and the rightness and goodness of your ideology or your nation or whatever, and if it doesn't bother you that by leaving your confirmation bias unchallenged, you're contributing to the fracturing of your nation and of the whole world along tribal lines, and you're possibly helping to usher in the apocalypse, then fine if that doesn't bother you. Have a nice day. But just in case you should decide that you want to play a part in saving the world and also cultivate a clearer view of the world, I will now give you the secret to fighting confirmation bias. Actually, I already gave you part of the secret. Pay attention to your feelings. And social media is a good place to do that, because it can feed you an endless stream of information that elicits various kinds of feelings. What a great opportunity for practice. So sit down with a laptop or tablet or smartphone and start scrolling. And every time you see an item that gets your attention, that gets you to stop and actually read it, then after you read it, close your eyes and try to get a better feel for your feelings. Do you detect a particular feeling that came in response to this item? Keep your eyes closed and observe that feeling for a while. You might even examine some of its subtler properties. Where in your body is it felt? Does it have a shape, a texture? If you're into mindfulness meditation, you may recognize this exercise as something you've already done. And if you're not into mindfulness meditation, and you're sick of hearing people talk about mindfulness meditation, then forget that I mentioned it. Don't think of this as mindfulness meditation. Just think of it as investigation, or reflection, or introspection, or phenomenology, but whatever you call it. If you keep doing it on a fairly regular basis, you may notice something. As you become more aware of your feelings, better at seeing them when they first arise, you become less reflexively obedient to them. Getting more in touch with your feelings can actually reduce their power, which can mean that your thoughts are less shaped by them. Your view of the world is less distorted by them. You're seeing things more clearly. Now, if you're worried that this will drain you of ideological passion and take the joy out of your social media life, I bring good news. That's not what people who do this kind of thing regularly tend to report. They tend to report that a clearer view of the world goes hand in hand with a happier life. Plus, they're helping to avert the apocalypse. And that's a good feeling.